strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Lord, open our lips.
And our mouths shall proclaim your praise.
Glory to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever.
Amen.
The Lord is full of compassion and mercy. Come, let us adore him. Come, let us sing to the Lord.
Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation.
Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving.
Raise a loud shout to him with psalms.
For the Lord is a great God.
And a great King above all gods.
In his hand are the caverns of the earth.
And the heights of the hills are his also.
The sea is his, for he made it.
And his hands have molded the dry land.
Come, let us bow down and bend the knee.
And kneel before the Lord our Maker.
For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand.
Oh, that today he would hearken to his voice.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever.
Amen.
The Lord is full of compassion and mercy. Come, let us adore.
Prophesy to these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. I will lay sinews on you, and you will cause flesh to come upon you, and cover you with skin, put breath in you, and you shall live. And you shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I had been commanded. And as I prophesied, suddenly there was a noise, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to its bone. I looked, and there were sinews on them, and flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath, prophesy, mortal, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live. I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived, and stood on their feet, a vast multitude. Then he said to me, mortal, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up, and our hope is lost. We are cut off completely. Therefore prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people, and I will bring you back to the land of Israel. And you shall know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people. I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live, and I will place you on your own soil. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken and will act, says the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Read Canticle 14 responsibly by half verse. O Lord and ruler of the hosts of heaven,
God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and of all their righteous offspring,
you made the heavens and the earth
with all their vast array.
All things quake with fear at your presence.
They tremble because of your power.
But your merciful promise is beyond all measure.
It surpasses all that our minds can fathom.
O Lord, you are full of compassion,
long-suffering and abounding in mercy.
You hold back your hand.
You do not punish as we deserve.
In your great goodness, Lord, you have promised forgiveness to sinners,
that they may repent of their sin and be saved.
And now, O Lord, I bend the knee of my heart,
and to make my appeal sure of your gracious goodness.
I have sinned, O Lord, I have sinned.
And I know my wickedness only too well.
Therefore I make this prayer to you.
Forgive me, Lord, forgive me.
Do not let me perish in my sin.
Nor condemn me to the depths of the earth.
For you, O Lord, are the God of those who repent.
And in me you will show forth your goodness.
Unworthy as I am, you will save me in accordance with your great mercy.
And I will praise you without ceasing all the days of my life.
For all the powers of heaven sing your praises.
And yours is the glory to the ages of ages. Amen.
A reading from the book of Romans. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh. You are in the spirit. Since the Spirit of God dwells in you, anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal body. Who through his spirit that dwells in you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. 16 and use it. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel. He has come to his people and set them free. He has raised up for us a mighty Savior, born of the house of his servant David. Through his holy prophets he promised of old that he would save us from our enemies, from the hand of all who hate us. He promised to show mercy to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant. This was the oath he swore to our father Abraham, to set us free from the hands of our enemies, free to worship him without fear, holy and righteous in his sight all the days of our life. You, my child, shall be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his way, to give his people knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of their sins. And the tender compassion of our God, the dawn of our eyes shall break upon us, to shine on those who dwell in darkness and the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace.
A reading from the Gospel according to John. Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent a message to Jesus, "Lord, he whom you love is ill." But when Jesus heard it, he said, "This illness does not lead to death. Rather, it is for God's glory, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it." Accordingly, though Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, after having heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to his disciples, "Let us go to Judea again." The disciples said to him, "Rabbi, the Jews were just now trying to stone you. Are you going there again?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk during the day do not stumble, because they see the light of this world. But those who walk at night stumble, because the light is not in them." After saying this, he told them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to awaken him." The disciples said to him, "Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will be all right." Jesus, however, had been speaking about his death, but they thought that he was referring merely to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." Thomas, who was called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that God will live and will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." When she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary and told her privately, "The teacher is here and is calling for you." And when she heard it, she got up quickly and came to him. Now Jesus had not yet come to the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. The Jews who were there, who were with her in her house, consoling her, saw Mary get up quickly and go out. They followed her because they thought that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping. He was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. And Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench because he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you have sent me." When he said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with the strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. And Jesus said to them, "Unbind him. Let him go." Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Martha and had seen what Jesus did, believed in him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
From our prayer for today. Among the swift and varied changes of the world, our hearts may surely be fixed where true joys are to be found. Swift and varied changes of the world. That seems about right, doesn't it? Changes are as fast and varied as anything I have ever experienced. The past few weeks, we've all had to ponder anew. New ways of gathering, like right now. New ways of loving, new ways of giving, and finally, new ways of being God's hands and hearts. Correction, God's clean hands and clean hearts in this place. And I imagine with all the feelings out there that all of our parish family has, as well as the community, it just might feel like it does for me, a Mary Poppins bag full of emotions. And if you remember the story, the book, or the movie where the children watched as Mary Poppins reached into her travel bag and pulled out tall floor lamps and houseplants, and if you're anything like me, that's what it feels like. And oh, how I wish, being quarantined with two toddlers, I had a Mary Poppins bag in my house, because I'm running out of ideas. And as far as being prepared for any of this, we've all had to put the guidebooks of our vocations on the shelf and away for a while. Learning to shepherd the flock without being able to see the sheep is, well, daunting. Some days it feels futile. And entertaining toddlers while tending to the sheep, as you can imagine, is a whole other challenge, as it is for so many of our families. And all the while we're overwhelmed with headlines that give announcements that we never thought were possible. Church is suspended. Holy Week and Easter is not happening within the building. I'm sorry if this is first time you hear this news. At the same time, we are the church. While we are used for gathering in corporate worship and then sent out to serve God in the world, this time is a stark reminder that worship is not limited to a building or space. And as the church, it's how we respond to things. How we respond to the current swift and varied changes of the world, where people will know that we're Christians. Because so much of the story of God's people happened without a formal gathering place. Ancient Israel experienced the reality of a destroyed temple. The apostles scattered as their teacher received the death penalty. And the first believers hide in secret as their brothers and sisters are being persecuted and killed. The people of God's hearts will surely there be fixed somehow where true joys are to be found. This time of social distancing, I hope, is a way of showing love to the most vulnerable ones among us. It's not a time for everyone to have something to offer, but it's a time for listening and waiting. A time to call ourselves back to our Creator, and the hope of resurrection is as real as ever. And if any of us need a reminder, Easter is the celebration of Christ's victory over death. It was never about choosing money over life or safety. And when and if the church must choose, the decision is always an easy one. But it is incredibly hard to navigate right now. And I wonder, unlike so many other catastrophic events of our time, there's no way of knowing when and how the worst of this pandemic will take full effect. There is no aftermath of the storm yet. A few weeks ago, the feeling was everything is thrown out of proportion, and then it became, that will never happen here. And now, well, we don't know. Nobody knows, even if people say otherwise. It reminds me of so much complacency that we have with so much of God's work. Not us, not here, not now. And in these unpredictable times, we all turn back, as we do during Lent, to the good news, wherever we can find it. I wonder if it is for us, as it was for Ezekiel, that we are brought out, set in the middle of a valley of disaster and death, of dry bones. And it's important to remember that it was the Spirit who led Ezekiel to that place. That's an important detail. The Spirit, too, leads Jesus to the wilderness. Because if we miss the point, if we believe that life of faith is just about chronic happiness, and we miss the point if we believe that disasters happen because of God's retribution, no. We are here. And if the story of today of Martha and Mary and Lazarus can tell us anything, Jesus needs to wait sometimes too. God waits so that God can share the human emotion of uncertainty and grieving and loss. Jesus chooses not to go and heal Lazarus immediately, but stays put for 2 whole days. The Word made flesh did not go save someone that they loved, even though they had the power to do so. Jesus did not speak, did not fix, did not pretend to be an expert in the situation. No, Jesus waited. God waited. Going back to the very beginning of Lent is the temptation of Jesus in the wilderness. And part of that temptation was Jesus could have been the Messiah to end the world of all sickness. Jesus could have been the Messiah to save the world from all epidemics and plagues and diseases. Could have kept COVID-19 from ever being a thing. But this is not why God came into the world, is it? No, instead, this Messiah is going to be the Christ who gives witness. The Christ who gives witness to a God who is good. expressing gratitude when everything's going just right. And that's exactly what happens with Martha and Mary. They wait. And after we've been quarantined for a few weeks, the story certainly relates to us. That they're in a closed home. Surely cabin fever is as real as ever. And they wait for their Savior who doesn't come in time for death to devastate the house. Disappointment, confusion, concern. Lord, if you had been there. The truth of the matter is that being as close as we are to our own experiences, we can't always see God's perspective in loss, economy, loss of jobs, marriage, life, or whatever. To be sure, we may not recognize how God is present with us, but we trust somehow that God is aware. All is not dead. Like Lazarus, it may be sleeping. It is the waiting that is the lesson today. It's that spiritual muscle that we all neglect, that the church must flex right now. This is the lesson from Martha and Mary that even though all hope seems lost, Lazarus has died, they wait for what they do not know. And amid this waiting that God moves, it is in the waiting past the point of hope that somehow God will always move. Because sometimes disappointment and faith go together. Mary and Martha do not demand a fix. They know what Jesus can do. And before he does anything, they continue to believe that the word that's been made flesh will be the source of all their hope. And they will remain faithful. Even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him, they say. In the same way, we are to remain faithful. And we are to remain faithful because we know that Jesus will act, that Jesus will go ahead of us to that valley of where it seems to be only dead, to the shadow of death, to the place where he'll feel the most vulnerable and threatened, and yet there is where God sees us and grieves alongside us. Be patient with God. God's understanding of the timing of things may look different from ours. Hold on a little longer. Here, near the end of Lent, when there seems to be no end in sight, no life in sight, as good time as any to be reminded that God moves in God's time. Maybe God will grant us grace to live in the waiting, to better allow for that surprise at an empty tomb. And as I preach to what seems to be empty pews, a place where we all stand in the valley of dry bones, waiting in restlessness, uncertainty, and fear. We know now, even now, God brings life in a world permeated with death and destruction. This time just might restore our ability to see God's faithfulness in all things. And in the end, maybe, we may just see, as Ezekiel learns to see. And you shall know that I am the Lord. When I open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people, I will put my spirit.